Hi guys, how are you? Hi, my name is Carlo, and we now have a special guest here, Roberto Velasco, co-founder and CEO at HDF Security. Hello, Roberto. Are you around? How are you?
Hello. Hi. Fine.
Well, we are very grateful and very happy with your presence here. It's a great pleasure to have you here with us, you know. So just to everyone knows, Roberto is a recognized expert in the cybersecurity industry. He has been involved in the IT and security industry for the past 20 years, and he has experience in software development, software architecture, and application security with different sectors such as banking, government, and energy. He's the CEO and founder of HDF Security, a company that offers a unified application security platform. Prior to founding HDF Security, Roberto worked for 8 years as a software architect and co-founded Arima, a company specialized in software architecture. He regularly speaks at software architecture and cybersecurity conferences, such as Spring and APUW, and he holds a master in computer science and business and entrepreneurship course from the University of Cambridge. Okay, and the topic of his presentation will be making DevSecOps a reality. So before to start, I ask to the listeners that if you have any question to use chat to ask them, and well, we will answer them at the end of the keynote, okay? Roberto, are you ready to start?
Yeah, thank you for having me. Okay, so I will share my slides first. Okay, can you see that? Can you see the screen? Yeah?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Okay, so let's start. Well, thank you very much.
Roberto,
for
I can see it, the present your presentation mode. I can see the management part, not the other. No.
Okay, sorry. Okay. Okay. This one. Okay, now, yes. Okay, thank you. Okay, so let's start. Well, thank you for the presentation as well. So my name is Roberto Velasco. As you have said, I have been involved in cybersecurity and software development and architecture for many years. And currently I am the CEO and one of the founders of HDF Security, a company specialized in application security or software security, okay? Yeah, particularly in the area of vulnerability detection and application protection, okay? So today when we are gonna talk about how to make DevSecOps a reality, because you probably have heard a lot about DevSecOps, but how to move from that idea, from that dream to something that you can use, right? So to a reality. So basically we will focus to give practical examples about how to do it. Okay. So let's start talking about the changes that we have seen in application development. Okay. At least in my case, I have been doing applications for many years. So in the past, when we develop an application, we have like very defined steps before going to production. So right now, I think it has changed completely. So in that case, we have a deployment to production almost every day, every hour in some cases. So it's very difficult to implement the traditional steps that we did in the past in that new scenario where we don't have time to move to those changes, right? So in addition to that, we have other additional changes. One of the most important one is that transition to the cloud. I mean, in the past we have like a local infrastructure where we have our own servers, our own network, But when we have moved to the cloud, everything it's different. So in that case, it's not too so easy to use the traditional solutions and the way that we work in the past. Okay. In addition to thanks to those cloud deployments, everybody is expecting that we will be flexible and scale with the platform, right? Because those cloud platforms, they scale without any human task. So everybody is expecting that in the rest of the requirements, such as security, we will have the same performance, right? So I think that that's a new reality. Okay. Obviously, the DevOps movement has been highly successful. I think that almost every company it's doing some kind of DevOps, so it's at least it's moving to a DevOps culture. So, but the question is, what about security? Are we in the same situation regarding security? I will say that we are not in the same situation, unfortunately. I think that the security, it's just starting, adapting to this new reality. So we have relevant challenges to solve, to adapt security in those new scenarios. One of the most important one, as I explained previously, is the time. I mean, right now, moving so fast to production, we don't have time, okay, to perform the traditional steps that we did in the past, like, you know, a manual pen testing, a web scanning, things like that are not easy to have, like, updated with those constant deployments, right? So it's very difficult to adapt. In addition to that, obviously, it's necessary to be integrated in those new cloud scenarios. I mean, it's not the same operate locally or in a enterprise network, or doing that in a public cloud, for instance. Okay, so that integration is a key factor. Obviously, moving to those cloud or virtual scenarios, if we are based on hardware or traditional solution, is not easy to adapt, right? Because it's in those new scenarios we are basically talking about software that we deploy through the internet, so there is no option to put a hardware component inside that architecture, because we don't have the way to put that, okay, because everything it's virtual. And obviously, it's relevant as well, the way that we have worked till now. I mean, traditionally, development and security teams has worked, you know, like a silos with no clear communication between departments. So that's something that in this new DevOps culture must be solved, right? Because the communication between both departments, it's critical, right? So, okay, once we have seen that this new reality and how we need, let's see now how we can do that, okay? So we will see, like, how to do it in practice in three different stages. The first one, it will be development. The second one will be CI/CD stage. And lastly, production environment. Okay, so let's start with the development environment and how we can implement that reality in that stage. Okay, obviously it's very clear that as soon as you start with the security, it's better, okay, and it's cheaper to fix the issues that you detect in your code, right? If we do it later, it's more expensive, it's more complicated to do it properly, right? So what can we do to solve that? I will advise, or we'll define three steps to do so, okay? The first one is think about design before we start doing or implementing the application, okay? I understand security as a process, where if we don't think about security in the first stage of the design of the application, it's very complicated to fix afterwards. We can solve some of the problems, we can detect some of the issues, but depending on the typology of the issues, if we haven't thought about that before, probably the fix will require to rebuild or reconstruct the whole application, right? Let me give you a specific example about a design issue that if we don't think about it in the beginning of the application, we are not able to fix it afterwards. Okay, so we will see now a very simple example of a design issue that that is necessary to think in the beginning of the application. Okay, so let's see a very simple example. In that case, it's an access control issue, where imagine that we have a URL, we are exposing a URL in the browser, where within that URL we have the account number of one specific user. So let's see what happens if we change that number. Okay, in order to trying to see the activity of another account number that is not our own account number. Okay, so changing that number and sending that request against the server, we can see in that case the activity of another account that is not our account, right? So these kind of issues, in that case, an access control issue, even though it's very simple to see in that example, they are not simple problems, right? I mean, if we don't think about the design of the application in the beginning, these kind of issues could be huge, okay, in the end, okay? So that's an example about what we think or what I am thinking about when I talk about design, okay? So what can we do to overcome or to reduce the complexity of these kind of issues, okay? One advice, even though some of the issues must be solved manually or with people, I will highly recommend to trying to use frameworks or architecture solutions that can automate those kind of validations or those kind of protections, okay? So any solution that depends on people, usually, you know, it generates mistakes, right? Because in the end, if we depend on people, it's very difficult to have everything fine, right? So thinking about architecture, trying to automate that, I think it's a key aspect. Okay, we will see an example of that in the end of the presentation to recover that issue. Okay, as second step, I will highly recommend to perform training and education. For instance, we have open source reference like OWASP and so on. And I will say that instead of doing traditional security, you know, imagine that you have a couple of days, five hours per day, that is like the traditional education that we usually do. Try to use like contextual education. I mean, there are good tools out there, some of them that we are talking with as partnership, like Secure Code Warriors, for instance, that give you some like contextual training. When you are, imagine that you are fixing a specific issue, so you have like a specific training in that specific moment solving that problem, okay? So in our opinion, that contextual training works better comparing with the traditional trainings where you have like many hours all together, right? So that contextual training, I think it makes a lot of sense, and I think that there is a clear movement to that, okay? And finally, fortunately, a significant part of the security issues can be detected with tools. Not all of them, but a significant part of them can be detected, right? So what we need, basically, we need to detect those coding issues within our custom code. I mean, code that we are coding, proprietary code that we are coding in our application. And obviously, as you know, many of you are doing, guys, we are using open source or third party components. I mean, components that are not developed by us, but we are consuming in some way, right? Usually open source dependencies. So it's very important to detect the vulnerabilities on those open source components as well, because they are, in the end, they are part of the application, okay? So so let's see an example about how to use this kind of solutions. Okay, so in that case we will use a solution in that case provided by HDIF, but we could have a similar experience with any other tool that you are using. So in that case, let's start with the installation of the solution. In that case, imagine that we are working in an IDE. Okay, in that case, it's Eclipse. So basically, we are going to install the solution. In that case, it's a solution that it's installed within the execution environment, the application server. It's very similar to APM solutions that probably you are using, guys. So once we install that agent, every execution that developer is doing within their local runtime, we will be detecting vulnerabilities. Okay, so there is no any friction in that. So any execution, any coding that we are doing, we will be detecting vulnerabilities. Okay, so that's the installation process. So once we have done this process, the next step is consuming that. Okay, so in the case of HDIF, when you are testing the application or using the application, we are able to show the vulnerabilities that we are detected, integrated in the application or even the ID, and reporting those vulnerabilities to the developer. Okay, that's what we told. That's what I was saying about fixing those vulnerabilities early in the development process. Okay, because it will be much cheaper to do it in that phase instead of doing in the end of the application. Okay, so in that case, HDIF is reporting different vulnerabilities. In that case, HTML resource integrity issues. If we move inside the application, if we use the application, it's not necessary in that case to perform any attack. Just browsing the application, we are able to detect the vulnerabilities. And in that case, we are reporting a couple of SQL injection vulnerabilities that probably is one of the most critical ones. So basically, in that case, we are reporting the dynamic view of the vulnerability, in that case, the URL and the parameter, and also the static view of the vulnerability, the file and the line. This second part of the static view, it's very relevant because the input that we are giving to the developer is actionable. I mean, if you know where the vulnerability is, you can go to that line and fix that, right? So that's very relevant to have, okay? And giving that feedback to the developer, okay? And obviously, it's important to give to the developer the way to fix the vulnerability. In that case, it's an SQL injection. So basically, the solution is based on a using prepared statement. So we can move to the ID, okay, to the line that we have the issue, and fixed it. Okay, so that's the way that we highly recommend developing. I mean, if you develop without a solution that is detecting that during the development, you will move to production. And it's very difficult to solve that in that situation, right? So I will highly recommend to have some kind of solution in that step. I think it's mandatory right now. Okay. So obviously in that case, the problem is based on, as you can see, that we are using the data that come from the internet without prepared statement. Okay. So that's the information about the vulnerabilities that we can detect locally. We have the detail of them to solve them. If we move from the application, we can see different vulnerabilities in that case. For instance, cross-descriptive vulnerabilities that are very common as well in many of the applications, particularly server-side ones. And as we mentioned before, it's important as well the part of vulnerable dependencies. I mean, in that case, it's a software composition analysis feature where we can see the vulnerabilities that are present in our dependencies. Okay, not in our direct code, in our custom code, but in our dependencies. Okay, in that case, HDIF has as well an aggregated view of the vulnerabilities that we are detecting. that that can be used to have that aggregated view of the functionalities as well. Okay, so once we have seen that, I think that we have explained which are the ideas that will be interesting for the development phase. So as a summary, think about the design in the beginning, think about training or some kind of education, and user detection solution. Okay, so those will be our advices to have a secure application and apply them during the development. Okay, so that's regarding the development phase. So let's see now what we can do in a later stage, in that case, a continuous integration or continuous deployment stage. Okay, so in that case, we move to a point where the developer has already, you know, committed the code. We have to build now the deployment, and we are going to do the delivery to production. So it's a very critical moment as well, because think about that. Actually, that was a comment from one of our customers that they told me, hey, for me, it's a good idea. It's nice to have those kind of solutions during the development, but for me, it's a must to having this kind of detection or measuring the quality of the code in the continuous integration and continuous delivery, because basically the development phase depends on people. They can be using or not those solutions, so we are depending on people. But the way that we build the application and implement the deployment, it's usually right now automated, right? Using different DevOps solutions, it's very common to have that process automated. So if we are able within that process adding additional security checks that don't depend on people, we are 100% sure that those checks will be performed, right? So I think that's a very relevant point. Okay, so what we need, basically, as I was explaining, it's relevant to add security to those functional and integration tags that we have within that build. It's relevant to define the threshold or the quality that we want to achieve in that test. It can depend on different factors. I mean, it's not the same when we apply a detection solution the first time in a project, because if it's the first time that you use detection, probably you will find many problems. Or once you have that solution in place for many months, probably you could define harder security policies. So it's a good advice to use, depending on the maturity of the project or the requirements of the project, you can define different kind of thresholds. But you can say, hey, if you find some critical security issue, don't go to production. Okay, if you have some minor security issues, you can go to production. Okay, these kind of policies usually are defined by the security or the architecture team, and don't depend on the developer. Okay, so we can assure that those quality, this kind of quality will be enforced. Okay, and as the final step, it will be great if we are able to see the evolution of this kind of detection. I mean, instead of doing a micromanagement where we are looking to each specific vulnerability, if we see the trends, the evolution of the different builds, different versions, and we see that there is a positive evolution, I mean, we have less vulnerabilities in each release, in each new version, probably the development team is doing a good job. Okay, but if we see a negative trend, or if we see that there is no a positive evolution, probably it means that we need to talk with them, okay, in order to fix that, right? So I think it's interesting to have that way to measure that. And finally, it's relevant to improve the communication with the development team. I mean, we talked in the beginning that those communication silos between departments, like the security and the development team, it's risky, right? So we need to improve that communication and fix it, okay? So let's see a practical example about how to implement that idea, but in practice, okay, based on software and based on security solutions, okay? So, okay, let me show you a practical example. In that case, we will see an example based on Jenkins that probably many of you guys are using. It's one of the most well-known continuous integration a solution. So, so in that case, we will see an example where we are going to define some thresholds. In that case, we will define a threshold based on the typology of the vulnerabilities. In that case, SQL injection. So we will define that if we find more than two SQL injection vulnerabilities, we are going to block or suspend the build, right? So once we save that policy within Jenkins, we execute the build and let's see what happens. Okay, in that case, the build failed because we have three SQL injection vulnerabilities. So the build it's failed, okay? And we are able as well to communicate the information of the vulnerabilities that we have detected to the security team as well, okay? So as we mentioned, improving the communication between teams, it's a critical task, okay? So instead of, you know, using like traditional Excel files that we send through email, so we need to know which is the owner of the code, so on. So with this kind of integrations, and in that case, with solutions like Jira, I mean, communication between Jenkins and Jira, we can perform that integration through software, okay? So it doesn't depend on people. So once we have solved the vulnerability, we can check it as done, okay? And once we have solved it, if we execute the build again, we will see what happened, okay? So we execute the build. In that case, it's a successful build. And we will release the software and we will move to production, okay? In that case. So it's very relevant to use those automations in order to assure that we are implementing those security policies properly. Okay, so okay, that's the second step. We have seen what we do in the development phase. We have seen what we do in the continuous integration and continuous developing the continuous delivery. So let's move now to the final stage, that is the production stage. I mean, probably we have done a good job in the previous steps, but if we don't have visibility or in the production environment, it's risky, right? We need to know what's happening inside the production environment. So what we are looking for? Basically, we need to avoid security incidents in that environment. We need constant or continuous security audit or security visibility about what's happening. And try to avoid security issues in that environment. Okay, so what it means exactly? First of all, we need to detect and block attacks in real time. I mean, once we are in production, if we detect some kind of attack, it's important to be able to block them, right? And monitor them and notify to the different stakeholders in the organization. In addition to that, it's a good idea to have a vulnerability detection system. I mean, even though we have tried to do our best during the previous steps, we are not 100% sure what's happening in production. So we need to be safe in that environment. So it's interesting to know which are the vulnerabilities that we have in that environment, such as it could be custom vulnerabilities, or it could be third-party open source library vulnerabilities, but vulnerability detection or vulnerability assessment, it's a critical part of the production environment, okay? So let's see now an example about how we can do that using a DevOps solution, an integrated solution that we can use in those kind of environments, okay? We have seen before the installation of the agent that we have done that in the local environment, but when we are moving to production, we usually use containers, right? We use Docker, this kind of solutions. Okay, so how we can install a security solution in that environment. Okay, so let's see in that case a Docker file configuration. In that case, we are installing the agent that we have seen before, but within a Docker container. Okay, so basically we add to the application server the agent that we have seen before, but we do that in the Docker definition. I mean, we are talking about software-based solutions. So once we do that, within each Docker instance, we have that security solution in place. Okay. So once we have installed that solution, we will operate it through in that case through a web console provided by HDF. Okay. So let's see what's happening. In that case, we have visibility about the activity that we have in production, and in that case, we can see, for instance, one specific example of an attack, okay, in real time. We know that it's trying to exploit an SQL injection, and we know that we have blocked the attack. Okay, so we have the details of the vulnerability. Okay. Okay. Okay, we can see the details as well of the servers where the problem is, the details of the server that contains that vulnerability. So that was the observability or the monitoring of the environment. Okay, when we are talking about security, we are not talking about only security. We need to know where the vulnerability is exactly, right? So in that case, we can see, for instance, which are the servers that we have in the production environment. We know which is the status, if they are running or not, if we have the security solution in place. So that visibility gives us the way to monitor that, to have an integrated vision between the security and the development departments. So all the teams can see that information, okay? In addition to that, we can see the vulnerabilities that we are detecting, organized by typology and so on. So as I said, even though within the development stage, it's interesting to know that within production environment, it's relevant as well to have that information. Okay, so look into the detail, we can see which are the details of the vulnerabilities, we can see the file, we can see the how many time, which is the window of exposure of the vulnerability, how many times has been detected, so all the details of the vulnerability, okay? And as we said, it's an actionable because we have the static view, the line of that, so with that information, without doing any you know, traditional web scanning, we have the information about all the vulnerabilities that we have in that environment, okay? So it's like a continuous way to monitor what's happening about vulnerabilities in the different stages of the application and the environments. Okay. Finally, I think it's really interesting. As I said, I don't believe in micromanagement of the vulnerabilities and each specific task. I highly believe in the trends. Okay. In that case, within the web console, we have a way to see the vulnerability trend of the different version of the different builds. Okay, so if we see a positive evolution, in that case we have a weekly view, it means that they are fixing, okay, the vulnerabilities. And on the other side, if we see a negative evolution, probably somebody is not doing their job, right? So I think that visualization of the trends of the fixing of the vulnerabilities, I think it's a very simple way to manage that, okay, and I have the information about how it's evolving that fixing process within our organization, okay. So that's a way to monitor that. In addition to that, within production, it's interesting to know, in addition to the application, which are the libraries that you are using, which of them are vulnerable. For instance, when it's very common when there is some news about a new functionality, you make the first question, are we using that version, where is deployed, right? So with this kind of monitoring or controlling of the production environment, we are able to answer those questions and monitor where we have that vulnerability, how to fix that, and so on. Okay, so that's all regarding the production environment. But we had a task pending that we haven't finished. That is the part of the we talked in the beginning of the talk about the design issues, right? We talk about a very well-known design issues problem, that is access control, okay? And we recommended to use some architectural or some general way to protect against those issues, okay? So even though it's possible to protect in those issues manually, I mean, using, you know, pen testing processes and then manual fixing, from HD we believe that it doesn't work in practice. Okay, I mean, it's very human dependent, and in addition to that, right now we don't have enough time to perform those manual pen testing and manual manual fixing, right? So let's see now, let's see the same example that we have seen before, but in that case, using a design solution, in that case provided by HDIF, where we can see how we can protect against those access control issues. Okay, let's see how it works. Okay, so we have the same scenario where we have a web application where we are exposing data that has been served by the server. In that case, we have the account number that we have within the URL, okay? So if we change this value and we try to see the activity of another account number that is different from us, in that case, we see a different result, okay? In that case, HDIF is blocking the attack, okay? So how we do that? And how we do that? Basically, HDIF is controlling all the information that we send to the customer. It could be in a traditional web application, it could be Forbes, it could be links that we send to the customer within a client-side MVC application where we are exposing APIs, HDIF analyze each piece of data like JSON data and so on. So thanks to that data flow controlling the data that we send to each customer, to each specific user, we can implement that contract enforcement algorithm, where if we see that the end user is changing that original behavior that we are exposing from the server side and the customer is changing that, we are able to block it, okay? So I'm doing that through the architecture of the application, okay? So that's an example about how what we can do if we apply security frameworks or security by design approaches, where we can automate those validation in some way, okay? And it's not only blocking, it help us as well monitoring what's happening, okay? So in that case, we are monitoring the attack. We know exactly which was the attack, even which was the user that was trying to do so. So we have all the information to, you know, to talk with the security team and take some action, right? Due to that attack. Okay, so that's an example about what we could do using security frameworks and security solutions that goes into the design of the application. Okay, so that's it. That's all from my side. I don't know if you have any question, any comment.
Thank you very much, Roberto. Thank you for your time and your knowledge. It's very interesting and very insightful on how to see how HDIF can help include the security on the DevOps practice, right? And as the business and IT teams work together, what are the tools and the mechanisms to bake that security in the design process? Really appreciate it. Thank you, Roberto, for your time and for being with us here today. Yes, we're going to jump into the questions, to the Q&A section of this part. I don't know if we have some questions on the chat.
Yes, we have some questions. Hi, Joseph. Well, the first one, Roberto, that we want to know is, we come from using a SAST, and it's very common to detect, a false positive. How do you approach this problem?
Yes. Yes, that's a very common problem. In our case, we use a different approach, a totally different approach. So the traditional SaaS solutions try to figure out, you know, from the code, they try to figure out how the application will be executed, how the data will be used within the application. Okay, so in our case, we decided to use a different approach because for us, it was very complicated to figure out how it's going to execute the code in production. So instead of trying to imagine that, we use like a real-time monitoring process where we are seeing that in real time. So we don't need to figure out, we see that, right? So thanks to that full visibility inside the application, we are able to solve those accuracy problems. It could be false positive or low detection level in the case of the Dust. So that's why we solve that, basically using a different approach.
Yeah, and it makes sense. Talking about the different approaches, let me ask you this other one, that our world and our infrastructure is ever more complex, right? And nowadays,
yes,
we've not just deployed on one single platform or architecture, right? Yes. So is your solution approaching the hybrid cloud and containers, maybe not containers, on-premise? So how do you guys handle that?
Yeah, good question. Yeah, as we have shown during the presentation, our solution is not based on hardware, it's based on software. So basically, as we have shown, you can add HD within a Docker container or this kind of ways to deploy to the cloud. So basically, it's a part of the application. So once you do that through software, it integrates naturally in those kind of environments. So it could be a private, a hybrid, you know, a public cloud. So it doesn't matter because basically it's like a part of the application. So we scale with application and we are deployed in the way that developers and the DevOps teams are deploying right now. So there is no any difference.
Good.
Great. And one more question, Robert. What are your requirements to detect vulnerabilities in production environment? I mean, is it necessary to provide credentials, definition of APIs in open API or similar format as we do with SAS, with Dust, sorry?
Yeah, okay. Yeah, yes. I mean, the traditional solutions to scan the application or to detect vulnerabilities in production basically are the Dust or the Dynamic Application Security Testing solutions that they try to browse the application by themselves. Okay, so basically they need to figure out how to browse the application, right? Within the traditional web applications, they were able to do so, but right now, there is a couple of major issues. The first one is that right now, the majority of the applications are based on JavaScript. So the way to navigate it's complex because the different steps are calculated in the client side. So they are not able to figure out how to browse by their own, okay? In the case of APIs, it's a similar scenario. With an API from outside the application, you don't know anything. You don't have any way to, you know, to ask the first homepage, and from the homepage you move to another page. No, you don't have anything. You don't have like the homepage. So in that case, it's necessary to give the information about which are the APIs that the application is exposing. There are some specifications to do so, like open specification, open API specification. It could be Swagger. Okay, so in order to scan an API, it's necessary to give that information to the Dust, also the credentials, you know, the login credentials and so on. So you have to cover those requirements that make possible that browsing, okay? But even in that scenario where you give all information to the Dask, there is other important weakness is that even in that case, usually they are able only to browse maybe 30% of the application. Okay, they are not able to browse everything because it's very difficult to browse from your own. In our case, we don't have that browsing requirement because basically we are monitoring the existing execution, and because we are inside the application, we don't have those requirements, and we are analyzing 100% of the application, because basically we are monitoring the data flow, the execution, the existing executions, and we don't have the complexity of simulating the browsing, because we monitor what's happening inside, right? Because we are inside the application, okay? So thanks to that approach, we don't have that requirement. You deploy the agent, and it just works. If you guys are using application performance monitoring solutions like Dynatrace, New Relic, that Datadog, these kind of solutions, basically it's the same, but in that case with the security part of detecting vulnerabilities or protection applications. Okay, so that's a good definition probably for you guys to have an overview about how it works.
Very good. Thank you very much, Roberto. We really appreciate having you here. We are very happy that you could join us today to share some of your knowledge and your expertise on the goodies from HDiff.
Great.
Thank you. And you guys don't go anywhere, right? We have three very special guests coming in right after that are going to be talking about optimizing secure hybrid cloud environments with Hitachi Vantara. Thank you very much, guys. We'll be back in a few minutes.
Thank you.